So we saw some procedures of stage one, the engaging style, okay, the building of a personal formulation, you remember, the procedures of self-monitoring real time, and also the collaborative weighing, okay. The last procedures of stage one is very, very important, is what we call the regular eating. The rational or regular eating is that this is a procedure that address the delay eating, that it is a form of dieting that it is very common about among patients with eating disorder. What does it mean, delay eating? Is for example, I skip breakfast, I skip lunch, and after I binge in the late afternoon or in the night, okay? This is very, very common. When we use with patients that are not underweight, the regular eating reduces the frequency of binge eating and also vomiting, while in patients that are underweight, the regular eating reduces the feeling full. That is a common problem of patients that are underweight, because they had the patient underweight in the consequences of under eating and underweight, they have a very slow gastric emptying, but when they feel full, they feel that they've eaten too much and they feel to have lost the control, and so they tend to restrict the diet, okay? If it works well, the regular eating produces a decrease in the degree of a preoccupation with food and eating in few weeks. So, and at the same time, there is a reduction of the binge eating and vomiting. And this is very engaging with the patient, and the reduction of binge eating and the preoccupation about food help the patient to address better the dietary restraint that we address in stage three of the treatment. There are two elements of regular eating. The first is eating at regular interval through the day, and three planned meals each day, plus two or three planned snacks. We call also these procedures the 3+2+0. Three means three meals, two snacks, zero, not eat between the gap, the interval, okay? And we ask the patient, try not to let pass more than 4 hours between every meal and snack. And here is an example: breakfast, mid-morning snack, lunch, mid-afternoon, evening meal, or evening snack also. This is common, for example, in England, where they tend to have a very early evening meals at 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock. In Italy, we eat at 8 o'clock. I don't know here at what time you eat, but it's not common to have an evening snack. This pattern of eating should be given priority to the patient. Sorry, but please wait a moment. Oh, questo è. Eccolo qua. Okay. And the patient should plan ahead. And there should rarely be more, as I told you, than a 4 hours interval between the planned meals and snack. And the patient are asked not to skip any of them, not to skip meals and not to skip snacks. It is important that we don't give any suggestion on what to eat and about the amount of it. So the goal here is just regular eating, eating 3 meals and 2 snacks, and the patient has to decide what and what, how much to eat. Okay. The patient also encouraged to eat with a clock, we say, so not be influenced by the feeling of hunger or fullness or by the preoccupation about weight, shape and eating. For some patients that have a very chaotic eating habits, and in patients that are highly restrictive, this may need a gradual introduction of this pattern in steps. For example, starting for breakfast, mid-morning snacks, lunch, and gradually to develop the regular eating procedure during the day. Please. I don't understand. Sorry, can you repeat?
There is a whole wave now back up with scientific documents published by Harvard Research with intermittent fasting. I'm not actually pro, but you actually can.
About the fasting.
Intermittent fasting.
Yeah. There are two problems. I know this because one of this was proposal of this was in Italian, Walter Longo, and there are two problems. The first that this people has a eating disorder psychopathology, that fasting is dangerous for this patient, so because it's maintained the eating disorder psychopathology, they fast, okay, and so any diet is contraindicated in this patient. The second, that all the study on intermittent fasting are preclinical. What does it mean, preclinical? They are study on rats or mouses. We don't have any data on the effect of intermittent fasting on longevity, reducing the cardiovascular risk or cancer in human. Because we need studies of 10, 15 years, 20 years. So is very problematic to suggest things like this before having good clinical studies. And all the people that advocate intermittent fasting are biologists or working in preclinical studies and with very short-term follow-up. So it is very problematic. Very problematic advice, in my opinion. We have also data that, especially in adolescents, the strict diet is one of the major risk factors of the development of eating disorder. So this advice is very dangerous, especially for the young, for the adolescent. Okay, so the diet in an adolescent is really a big problem because it is a high risk to develop, is one of the major risk factors of the development of eating disorder. Okay. So we have to give education to, but it's very difficult because now the young look at this information about the nutrition in the, you know, in the social network or things like this. And most of the times this indication about nutrition are not based on solid scientific background, you know.
When Harvard says, because I'm kind of what I received.
But it doesn't import, but are preclinical studies. It's like if you put in the market a drug on the basis just on preclinical studies.
I'm not arguing against you.
No, you understand, because this is the problem of science in general, because you know, a drugs, you do preclinical studies, and after you do stage one, stage two, stage three studies, okay, and after post-marketing studies. Here, in the nutrition, you do preclinical study, or you see some association between a disease and some eating, and you prescribe the diet as a drugs, but without any data, okay. What we know about the association between eating and health, you know, is one of the most difficult areas of the research because most of the data are derived by observational studies. So the the technology today is to take a population, to study the population every year, and to ask to the population what you eat, we have some questionnaire of the frequency of food, but the people don't remember very well what to eat. Okay, that's the problem. So we are not sure that it is real what they eat, and they change the eating during the course of their life. And we have no randomized control study to put, for example, a population in eating in this way, another population in other ways for many years. So we can give only general guidelines on the pattern on eating. We know, for example, Mediterranean eating is a pattern that seems associated with a good health, seems associated, because we have no randomized control trial, okay? But we have no data on the single nutrient, on the single approach. And remember that the extreme approach to diet works well in a short term, but in long term they tend to disrupt the behaviors of the individual. When you start to starve, you start to binge, you have to start, you disinhibit your eating behavior, and this is especially dangerous in the young people. So we need to educate, but it is difficult in this moment. It is difficult because they receive more information by social media than by the health people that is working in this field. We have no much possibility to inform well our young population. Okay, it's a big problem. Thank you for the question, very important. Okay, the second element is not eating in the gaps, and we help the patient to adopt two strategies. So resist between the gap, between meals and snack, okay? One is addressing the urge, and we ask the patient to plan some, for example, interpersonal activity. When you have the urge to eat, you can do some interpersonal activities like telephoning or visiting a friend, being with a friend, or getting out immediately from the situation, for example, going out for a walk, or changing the atmosphere, for example, playing music incompatible with binge eating, or some cognitive strategy, what we call urge surfing, is a strategy that we use also to help a patient to modulate mood. You can tolerate the mood, it's not a state, there is an increase of the urge and after go down, and here there are also some cognitive process that can help. The toleration is not a persistent, because the urge is a transitory phenomenon and I can tolerate the urge without eating. It's the same strategy that we use when we address mood intolerance. And this is a typical monitoring record of the patient. You see in the first part of the monitoring record, the patient plan in advance when to eat, what to eat, and the place, okay? And we only ask the patient to eat 3 meals and 2 snacks, and not eating between the gaps, okay? But the patient choose what to eat and where to eat. And after she trace a line, and she monitors in real time what she eat, okay? You see the brackets, okay? And also the 3 meals, okay? And also the asterisk, where she has eaten, and also the asterisk. Here you see exercise, because she exercised. And here there are the comments that the patient does. So there are, when we introduce the regular eating, the monitoring record is used in two ways. First, planning in advance, the day after, the day before the eating, okay, 3 meals and 2 snacks, and after, using the monitoring record, as I described you earlier, monitoring the eating in real time. Okay. If regular eating works, you see that there is a dramatic reduction of binge eating frequency. And this is the consequences of two aspects. The first is that we address a trigger of binge eating, so the delay eating, the skipped meals. When you skip meals, you have high risk to develop binge eating, okay? Biologically and cognitively, the all or nothing reaction. And second, the planning in advance is a good strategy to increase the control over eating, and also the strategy, what we described before, the addressing the urge, the urge surfing, help the patient to take the control over eating. And if this strategy works, you see a reduction of binge eating, and this is associated with reduction of about the preoccupation about eating. The patient usually see that the patient has no change in body weight and is also helped to interpret the weight change with the collaborative weighing, the other strategy procedure that I described you earlier. We also sometimes with adult patient involve significant others, always in adolescents, to create a possible environment to patient to benefit of CBT. And we see significant others for two main reasons. The first, when they could they be a resource. For example, to help to use some procedures, the regular eating. For example, we can involve significant others to buy the food or to cook the food that the patient planned to eat, okay? Or to resist to the impulse to binge. Or, this is very common, when they are creating an obstacle to change. And in this way, they tend to interfere with the treatment or its chance of success. For example, it's common that in the family there is another member that is dieting, or another member that is emphasizing the fitness, the control of eating, or is commenting negatively on the behavior of a patient. There is a high level of criticism, or over-involvement, or controlling. These are all reactions to the eating disorder feature that tend to maintain for several mechanisms the eating disorder. And so we try to involve the significant other to change some behavior, same attitude that can create an obstacle. So these are the two reasons why we involve the significant others. Another benefit of seeing significant others is that it may require, especially with patients with bulimia nervosa, normal weight, usually they tend to have a secret behavior. No one knows about the binge eating, the vomiting. So it may require the patient to come out of the eating disorder. And so when you come out, it is more difficult to keep secret behaviors like vomiting. And also it puts others in the position of help towards the patient. Remember, however, one of the most important maintaining mechanisms of the other is the criticism, the over-control. This creates a change of mood of a patient, increase the mood, the negative moods, the negative moods is coped by the patient, or increasing the control of diet or with binge eating. Okay, let's go now in the stage two. Okay, taking stock is, we have done the first eight session, and now is the time to do a review. Okay, stage two, as the rationale of stage two is a time set aside to review the progress, make adjustments, and plan ahead. The rationale is to do a detailed reassessment 5 weeks into the treatment, after the first part of the treatment, and it follows a relatively standard stage one. If you follow me, stage one was relatively standard. However, we made a personalized education with a formulation that is very personalized, but the three The other main procedures like self-monitoring, collaborative weighing, regular eating are very standard for all the patients because these are the basis on which we do the other changes. Okay. And I also told you earlier that the early change is the most potent predictor of outcome of the treatment. So it is for that reason that we do a stage 2 review after 4 weeks. And we dedicate 1 or 2 sessions to this review. And we do a joint assessment of the progress and compliance, and we reassess, for example, the eating disorder psychopathology with the EDQ, the questionnaire that I described you earlier, and the CIA, the clinical impairment assessment. We try to identify any additional barrier to change, and we decide to continue with a focus form of CBT, addressing the specific eating disorder psychopathology, or to move to the broad form of CBT, to address also some other aspect of the personality of a patient, clinical perfectionist, called low self-esteem, interpersonal difficulties, mood intolerance. And at the end, we plan the stage 3, which psychopathology to address. Stage 3 become very, very individualized treatment that we address only the psychopathology that is operating with the patient. In the same time, in these 2 sessions, we continue the strategies and procedures introduced in stage 1. So we continue the weighing, collaborative weighing, we continue self-monitoring in real time, and also the regular eating. The outcome of this reassessment, the first outcome is in most cases we see a progress. And the progress in most patients is reasonably satisfactory, even if the patient tend to underestimate the progress because they are very critic in general. But most of the patients you see, they regularize eating, they reduce the binge eating frequency. If you see a progress, this means that there are not obstacles. Okay? The patient is changing. Okay? So the goal here is continuous with a focus form of CBT because there are not external maintaining mechanisms that are maintaining the eating disorder psychopathology. And we move to plan the stage 3 of the treatment. If the progress are limited in the minority of the cases, we plan to go in stage 3, while we try to assess and to address any additional barriers to change, for example, the obstacle or, for example, the lack of motivation of the patient. And we, in this case, we think a lot to use or not the broad form of CBT, because maybe there are some external maintaining mechanisms that are an obstacle to change for the patient. We use the broad form of CBT, for example, this aspect, only if one or more of the 4 features present are feature below is present, for example, clinical perfectionist, core low self-esteem, market interpersonal difficulties, mood intolerance, and if this feature satisfies these 3 characteristics. The clinical perfectionist, for example, should be pronounced, maintain the eating problem, it is clear that clinical perfectionists tend to maintain the eating problem, and block the progress. And the same is for low self-esteem, interpersonal difficulties, or mood intolerance. If this, for example, clinical perfection is pronounced, but the patient is changing, there is not an obstacle to change. We don't address clinical perfection because it's not a major obstacle to change. Okay, this is the strategy we use. What does it mean, clinical perfectionist? A colleague of you asked me about the clinical perfectionist. Clinical perfectionist is a perfectionist clinical, of a clinical severity that create an environment. And is a form of an over-evaluation similar to the eating disorder psychopathology, because also clinical perfectionist is an over-evaluation of achieving an achievement in valued domains of life, for example, schools, sports, other aspect, okay? Quindi very similar. And this patient tend to put the clinical perfection in standard, okay, the over-evaluation of achieving in achieving a control of body weight or shape. Core loss self-esteem is a long-standing, unconditional negative view of self-worth. It's not the negative self-esteem secondary to the eating problem, for example, to the binge eating of not having friend, but is related to the eating disorder, is secondary to the eating disorder. This core loss self-esteem precede the eating disorder and it is not influenced by the state of eating disorder. The patient can binge or not binge, have control of eating or no control of eating, underweight or not underweight, there is no influence of core self-esteem. For this reason we call core low self-esteem, not just low self-esteem. Marked interpersonal difficulties are interpersonal problems that are unlike to respond to simple techniques like the problem solving that we use in the standard, in the focus CBT. A mood intolerance is a typical patient that usually receives a diagnosis of borderline personality disorder that have intense mood change that they have difficulties to tolerate. And they try to cope with this intense mood change that they perceive. We don't know if they are intense or they perceive it so intense. And they use what we call dysfunctional mood modulatory behaviors, like, for example, drinking, cutting, using substance that reduce the negative states but create an empowerment and maintain the mood intolerance. And this patient can use some feature of the eating disorder like binge eating, vomiting, but also dieting as a way to tolerate the mood. Okay. But this is only a subgroup of patients, I remember, because more than 50% of the patients respond to the focus form and this aspect are not relevant in obstacling the change and maintaining the eating disorder. Having done the stage 2, we plan the stage 3, but I remember you address the psychopathology that is operating in the patient. For example, now we are describing the focus form of CBT, and I describe the major modules of eating disorder, body image, the dietary restraint, events and moods and eating, and also setbacks and mindset. Some patients have these two modules, some patients have this module and this module, some patients have all this psychopathology that should be addressed with all these modules. The goals of stage 3 is to address the mechanisms that have been maintaining the eating disorder psychopathology, to address the remaining eating disorder feature that are operating in the patient, and to develop the ability to tackle setbacks. From the stage 2, if you remember, the session become weekly, and the treatment is highly, highly individualized. The stage 3, the first goal is to address the mechanisms that have been maintaining the eating disorder psychopathology of the patient, and the strategy is to employ one or more of the following modules: the body image module, I repeat, the dietary restraint and restriction module, and events, mood or eating. In order to decide which module to address first, the therapy should consider three variables, to take in account three variables. The first is the relative contribution of the maintaining process. What is the most important aspect of the psychopathology that is maintaining the eating disorder of a patient? The time it takes to address this aspect of the psychopathology, And the need for an early progress. The early progress is fundamental for engaging the patient. Okay. The goal two is to address the remaining eating disorder features. So I continue to implement the strategies and procedures introduced in stage one, but to introduce additional procedures in the context of the three modules, body image, dietary restraint, events, mood and eating. And towards the end of the treatment, the setbacks and mindset module is introduced. Okay. If you have some question, and after we go to review briefly the four modules. And I drink water. Okay. There is a question. Let's say we finish at 6 o'clock. False alarm. No question.
She was wondering if group therapy, if you think that group therapy is suitable for patients with
We don't encourage to do the group therapy because it's in very individualized treatment, this. So you can do with binge eating disorder and obesity because it's more uniform with psychopathology. So it is we suggest to do a one-to-one treatment for anorexia nervosa and bulimia nervosa. Thank you for the question. Pardon? Which type of therapy?
Urge surfing.
Yeah. Urge surfing is the surf or the urge, you know. we say to the patient, you have to think to the urge to eat as a, you know, a wave. Go up. And after go down, okay. And you have to surf the urge. To surf the urge, you can have to adopt two strategies, okay. One is distraction, okay. To, for example, interpersonal activities, change the mood, going out from the situation, okay. The second is tolerate the urge. Tolerate the urge is a cognitive process. More complex than the distraction, of course, because most of the patients do not tolerate the mood because they say it's too strong, this urge, I become crazy, I had to eat, it is impossible. Or for a patient with mood intolerance, say, I had to cut myself, I can't resist to this negative. And there is also a cognitive process that increase the difficulty in tolerate. When the patient say, I can't tolerate the state, I can't stay so bad, I had to do something, I had to eat, I had to cut myself, I had to drink, okay. This is what we call cognitive amplification, okay. Marshall Linehan described very well this aspect. Urge surf means that you say to yourself that this is a transitory state, reach a peak and after go down, and you can tolerate this. You can't tolerate. When you say to yourself that I can't tolerate this, you reduce the intensity of the urge and also of the emotion. But this is difficult, so we try to start with the patient suggesting distractive activity that is more easy at the beginning. But is when the patient is able to work on the cognitive process associated with the urge, it is clear that she gains control on this, okay? Okay.
I have one question. You mentioned treatment for comorbidities.
Yeah.
I was wondering if any of the patients you treat with psychotherapy are on any psychopharmacologic treatment
as well. Yeah. is a big problem. Big problem because in many times, first of all, we don't have any drugs that is working to address the eating disorder psychopathology. No one, zero. Okay, so we don't have any drugs that reduce the over concern about shape and weight. And we don't have also animal samples to study because the animals are not concerned about body weight and shape. This is a big problem. We have animals that are depressed, they have fear, anxiety, so we can study this, but not eating disorder. So no study have evidence that drugs works for eating disorder psychopathology. Most of the time, unfortunately, they are used to address the eating disorder psychopathology or to address the resistance of the patient. And this can create a damage, okay, because the drugs doesn't work and creates, maybe they have side effects and it doesn't work in treating the eating disorder psychopathology. We use the drugs and we address the comorbidity when we use a very pragmatic approach on comorbidity. First of all, we try to see if it's a true comorbidity or spurious comorbidity. True comorbidity is coexistent, spurious is secondary to the eating disorder. And this is for this reason it's important that the psychiatrist has a good understanding of the eating disorder psychopathology. Okay. The second is we see if the comorbidity, so the true comorbidity, is an obstacle or not to the CBT. For example, clinical depression is an obstacle and we address first the comorbidity, or substance misuse is an obstacle, or a severe bipolar state, for example, can be an obstacle, or a psychotic state, and we address first this comorbidity. But there are some comorbidities that are not an obstacle to CBT, but do not respond to CBT. For example, post-traumatic stress disorder or obsessive-compulsive disorder. In this case, we decide if to address first the eating disorder or the other comorbidity, but never together with psychological treatment. But for example, we can treat OCD with drugs and to do the CBT for addressing the eating disorder psychopathology. Okay. So this is a strategy that we use. And also for the medical comorbidity like obesity, diabetes type 1, celiac morbus, or other medical, general medical condition that can interfere with and can maintain the eating disorder psychopathology. Okay. So when you work in a team, it is important that also the people that is assessing the comorbidities is an expert in the eating disorder psychopathology and work together with the therapist that is delivering the CBT, because otherwise, if for example is a psychiatrist, generalist psychiatrist, tend to see the comorbidity in all the patients and to prescribe drugs in all the patients. But most of the time, this is secondary to the eating disorder psychopathology. So it's a spurious comorbidity that doesn't interfere with treatment and is a typical consequence that responds to the treatment of the eating disorder psychopathology. I don't know if I was able to respond.
So how many of your patients were under
psychopathology? For antidepressant, about 30%. 30%. For clinical depression. For clinical depression. Only if there is a coexistent clinical depression, not secondary.
Thank you.
We don't finish. No, but it's better. There are three questions. I
have two questions.
Good.
How case formulation of eating disorders would sound like?
Would
sound like? I mean, if you can give us an example of case.
I would like, but we have no time, okay. Because I have to describe a patient with eating disorder. Maybe in the future, if we have occasion, I'd be very happy to to do some, to present some cases of eating disorder, okay, and to discuss how we do the case conceptualization of eating disorder. But we need more time. I'm sorry. We describe now if we have time. Thank you for the question. It's very important, this important question. It's a body image module that we try to explain. Yeah, but I prefer.
Just a brief question, because it's related to the previous one from here. I know that in the United States they are using a component of medical cannabis for anorexia with very low body weight. And actually, the FDA approved the medication, the medical cannabis, but the, for this kind of indication for anorexia with very low body weight, it is using off-label. So,
what they are using?
Medical. Yes, it's CBD.
Yeah.
It's a component of the.
I know. There are no good data supporting this, however, and it's dangerous because some patients tend to have an addictive behavior. So I saw patients that, but we have no good clinical trial on this. This is the problem. So I don't track.
Actually, it's only the part that is not inducing the
thing. Yeah, so I don't recommend. Orthorexia, yeah. Thank you for the question. There is a big debate in the field. Orthorexia is the preoccupation of eating healthy food. For the preoccupation, if you don't eat healthy food, you develop disease. Okay. This, we discussed before that the association between eating and health is very complicated, but is this people tend to restrict many food for the fear or the obsession to be healthy or the fear to develop some medical complication. But they create damage because they become they go underweight, so they become with malnutrition, and so they become. They develop an eating problem of clinical severity. They obtain the opposite. They avoid social situation. They become obsessed with food. It was not included in the SM5 because there are not many studies, especially regarding the development of this disorder, the outcome of this disorder. And now there is a tendency to include the orthorexia in the ARFID diagnosis. So the profile of artists, of the people that avoid the food for the fear of the consequences. And there are some ARFID, for example, are afraid to not to swallow, or not to breathe, eating, or to have digestive problem, or to develop allergies, or to develop illness, okay? So there is a restriction of eating without the fear of weight gain, okay? So this is, but it's very common. I don't know here in Romania, but for example, I started to do supervision in Norway because in Bergen we apply the intensive unit of Villa Garda in Bergen University almost 10 years ago. And they reported in the supervision many cases that were obsessed of healthy food. They didn't find many patients like this in Italy, but in the last 4 or 5 years there is an explosion of cases of eating disorder without the fear of weight gain, for the fear of a negative consequence on eating. And I think that this focus on healthy eating and eating and health, and also all this information that are not based on solid scientific basis can increase the risk of developing this type of behaviors. And maybe we are observing a change in the psychopathology of anorexia nervosa, because if you see how in the course of history how changed the psychopathology of anorexia nervosa, if you see for example the paper in the 800, they never spoke about the fear of weight gain, but they spoke about hypochondrias or hysteric anorexia nervosa or gastric anorexia nervosa. And after the body image problem appeared in the literature in the 900, okay, with a focus of control, focus on the body. And now we have a shift. I don't know if there is a shift, but we see patients like this very often, that there is a focus on healthy eating, the control of eating for the health that create damage. If you follow me in this brief history, you see the core aspect of the eating disorder doesn't change, that it is the control. And after there is a transformation of the meaning behind the control of eating, but the core maybe is the control, okay, of psychopathology. The change, the meaning change in the period of the history. If you go for the medieval, for example, it was a more, meaning to be in contact with God or things like this, more ascetic meaning. And now it is very difficult to see a patient with anorexia nervosa with high level of asceticism. But I remember when I was a young doctor, I found a patient like this. Okay. Last question, and after I think we move to body image is better. Okay. I can give only brief information because it's a little complex with the body image module. What I like to underline is that the distinction between over-evaluation of shape and weight and body dissatisfaction. Sometimes there is a confusion between these two constructs. The majority of the patients with eating disorder has the characteristic over-evaluation of shape and weight. And as I described you earlier, is the judgment of themselves largely or even exclusively in terms of shape and body weight, and the ability to control them. And this peculiar of patients with eating disorder is very rare in people without eating disorder. And we often describe this as the core psychopathology of eating disorder. And the over-evaluation appear to maintain much of the eating disorder psychopathology that we see in the patient, and should be distinguished by body dissatisfaction. Body dissatisfaction means I'm not satisfied with my body, be my body weight, be my body shape, but body dissatisfaction is normative in our culture. I don't know how many of you are satisfied, completely satisfied of the body that you have, okay? But this is not being unsatisfied of the body is not a clinical problem. Okay, I am satisfied of my body, but okay, I judge myself on other aspects. For example, I am a father, I have friends, I have a work, I have a hobby, many other things. I would like to have a different body, maybe. But so it is different body dissatisfaction to the over-evaluation of shape and weight. The over-evaluation, some patients are satisfied of their bodies. For example, patients with anorexia nervosa are satisfied to be so thin. They have no body dissatisfaction because they like the body they have, but they have the over-evaluation of shape and weight. And many people are dissatisfied of a body, but they don't have over evaluation of shape and weight. This is important also when we share the goals of a treatment with a patient, because the goal of a treatment is not that the patient arrives to be satisfied with her body, okay, but to reduce the importance that the patient attributes to the body, weight and shape, in evaluate herself. I hope that I was able to explain the difference, because it's crucial in the treatment of eating disorder, okay? So the goal is to reduce the importance associated to body weight and shape, not to become happy, satisfied, like my body, because it's not common. It's not, the people is not so with the body, okay? In the past we made these mistakes in general. The core psychopathology, as I told you earlier, can be represented graphically in form of a pie chart. Okay, you see this typical pie chart of a person without an eating disorder. There are many slices, and every slice is an area of self-evaluation. In people with eating disorder, the over-evaluation, there is a dominant slice, you can see your shape and weight, and very few other slices of little importance. So there are few slices and little. Okay. Why we have to address the core psychopathology? Because the core psychopathology has various consequences, we call also expressions, okay? And one of the major consequences is the attempt to control the body weight, using, for example, extreme weight control behaviors, the typical extreme weight control behaviors that we see in patients with eating disorder. And for this reason, the core psychopathology is, we put the core psychopathology at the top of the most eating disorder formulation, if you remember. This is the core psychopathology that we put at the top of the most formulation of eating disorder. There are, however, other expressions that we didn't explain there are other expressions that are directly expressed by the over-evaluation of shape and weight that are not included in this formulation, that, however, contribute to maintain the eating problem and the body image, the negative body image. These are the body checking, the body avoidance, the feeling fat, and the marginalization of other life, or the other areas of life. The general strategies to address body image with CBT has four steps. The first, identifying the over-evaluation and its consequences. The second is enhancing the importance of other domains of self-evaluation. The third is addressing shape, checking and avoidance. And the fourth is addressing feeling fat. The psychopathology that we address, the first step is educate the patient on the particular aspect of the psychopathology. So we try to explain to the patient in general what is the self-evaluation. And we say, for example, it is an abstract concept, self-evaluation. However, practically, in general, the people tend to evaluate themselves in terms of how they function in some domains of life. For example, in works, in school, the quality of relationship they have, in sport, in hobby, in the family function, things like this. In people with eating disorder, sometimes when there is the eating disorder mindset, the eating disorder, the body weight, shape and eating control become one of the major domains of self-evaluation. The difficult part is to help the patient to assess their self-evaluation, and for doing this, in doing this, we ask the patient to write the things that are important in order of their importance. And the clues, as I told you earlier, comes from how the patient feels when something goes wrong in this area of life. For example, I feel very bad because I had a bad marking at school, or I fail in a sport activity, and I feel very bad, and this negative feeling lasts for many hours or days, probably is an important area of self-evaluation. Okay? If, for example, I fail in a sport, but at the evening I am happy, it's not so, you know, it's okay, I prefer to win, but I lose, for me, but it's not so negative a reaction, this means that it's not a very important area of self-evaluation. And we, if a patient doesn't include the body weight and shape, we ask, try to think also of this area of self-evaluation. How is intensive a negative reaction you have when something goes bad in controlling body weight, shape, and eating? Okay. And after we put in order importance and we draw a pie chart, and regularly we review the pie chart of the patient in the following weeks. The step three, we in the next session we review the pie chart, we consider the pie chart and whether it has changed, and is there the over-evaluation, and we discuss the implication of a pie chart. As I told you earlier, it is risky to evaluate a cell predominantly in one domain. It's like to have all the eggs in a bucket, in a box, if you, you know, because if you have no control, for example, in body weight, or your self-evaluation go down, it narrows the life and it is self-perpetuating, the marginalization of life, and it is inherently problematic because it's very difficult to reach success in controlling body weight and shape. It's the typical domain where you have never success. So the problem with a patient with eating disorder is that they are never happy. They have never a good evaluation of themselves, because it's never enough. They restrict the life and also other domains of life. They lose the control and they decrease the self-evaluation, and they are never happy of the result they reach. The step four is to identify the consequences, what we call the expression. We have other already identified, the dieting, for example, the vomiting, the excessive exercise, but also other direct expression of the eating disorder, of this over-evaluation, like the marginalization of other life, areas of life, the body checking, the body avoidance, and the feeding fat. And we consider the role of over-evaluation in maintaining the eating disorder psychopathology of the patient, and we refer to the patient formulation. And we consider also that the direct expression, body checking, body avoidance, feeling fat, the marginalization of life are impairing, and we create what we call the extended formulation. And we discuss also the two-prong strategy to address the over-evaluation. This is an extended formulation of the eating disorder. It's a patient that is underweight. There is the over-evaluation of shape and weight, the pie chart, okay, the strict dieting, the significant low weight that maintain the strict dieting and the over-evaluation, but also other direct expression of the over-evaluation of shape and weight. For example, shape and weight checking and or avoidance, that is the direct expression of the over-evaluation, but in turn maintain the over-evaluation and increase the preoccupation with thoughts about shape and weight. If you continue to check your body, it increases the preoccupation about the shape of your body. Or another aspect is what we call the mislabeling adverse states as feeling fat. I have a negative emotion, I label this negative emotion as I feel fat, and after the marginalization of other areas of life. And you see, this expression in turn tend to maintain the over-evaluation of shape and weight, and the significant low weight is another mechanism that maintains the marginalization of other areas of life. And you see, there is in this extended formulation how many mechanisms are maintaining the psychopathology of eating disorder. One of the problems of eating disorder, if you compare with anxiety disorder, that is complex, the psychopathology of eating disorder. There are many expressions that in turn to maintain the core psychopathology. Having done the formulation, we describe with the patient, to the patient the two strategies to address the over-regulation. One is to increase the importance of other domains of life, to address directly the marginalization, so to help the patient to develop new domain of self-evaluation, okay, to increase the number of the slices of the pie chart. And the second is to reduce the importance of shape and weight, addressing the direct expression of the over-evaluation of shape and weight, such as body checking, shape avoidance, and feeling fat. So to reduce the dimension of the slice of the over-evaluation of shape and weight. To enhance the importance of other domains of self-evaluation, we explain the rationale to do this, and we help the patient to identify new activities in which the patient might become involved. For example, or activity before the onset of the eating disorder that have been stopped with the eating disorder, or things that she or he might like that she has never done. This is a good opportunity to start new activities, okay? We agree to one or two possibility, and we encourage the patient to find activity that involve others, interpersonal activities with peers, because this is a strategy that can this domain can be maintained because there is interaction with others, and the improvement of interpersonal relationship can reduce the importance that they attribute to the body in evaluating themselves. We ensure that the patient start actually to engage in the identified activities, and we ask to record the activity in the last column of the monitoring record. I said you before that we use the monitoring record in different way in a different part of the treatment, and we review the progress week by week. Another aspect is addressing body checking. Body checking is very common for the people in general, especially in the young. They check the body to some extent, but many young people with eating disorder repeatedly check their bodies, and often do in a so way that is very unusual. For example, they stay for half an hour in front of a mirror without dress to look at the body in front, lateral, behind, from they look at the stomach, they pinch the skin fold, they measure the circumferences of the body, they compare the body with the others, okay? So it is really unusual and extreme, this type of body checking. I have some patients that they do body checking all the day, hour, minutes by minutes, hour by hour. So it is different from the typical checking that we have when we wake up in the morning. We look at our mirror, we see how is our hairs, the people that have the hairs, or or so to take a look how we are. Okay, they go in detail. They focus in them to find any defect they have. And so such body checking, what is the problem? That become a behavior of what we call second nature. It's automatic. The patient are not fully aware to have this type of behavior. And we know from the study that we made from body checking that is very influential in maintaining the body weight, the body shape dissatisfaction, and the body's shaping dissatisfaction encourage dieting and the adoption of extreme weight control behavior. So how to address body checking? The first step is explaining the rationale, the extended formulation. And the second step, we help the patient to identify the various forms of body checking. It is not simple because, as I told you earlier, many patients are not aware of doing these behaviors, and for this reason, and it's also stressful to monitor body checking, so we ask the patient to monitor for 2 periods or 24 hours every type of body checking they are doing, and we use an adaptive form of self-monitoring, and in the next session we review the monitoring record and we go in detail to ask the patient, what are you trying to find out when you do body checking? Why do you check so frequently? Why you continue to do body checking? Do you think that your body weight change or body shape change in a minute? Or what you are trying to find? And the people say, I try to see if my body weight is change or is not change, if I have thin, if I have a bone, okay? Have you ever looked a part of your body that you like? Rare. They are focused just on specific body part of the body, for example, the legs, the stomachs, the bottom, things like this. Do you feel better after body check? Most of the patients say no, or some patients say, yes, I feel well because I see that my body is not changed, but this wellness last few minutes because they have to repeat immediately the body checking. Do you think that the body checking has negative effect? Yes, the negative effect is that they encourage the body dissatisfaction in the diet. And this is too small, but is an adapted monitoring record. You see always the first columns, time, food and drink consumed, place, the asterisks, the vomiting laxative exercise, and here we include the column or check type and time. So every time the patient do body checking, we ask the patient to write in real time the type of body checking and the time they dedicate to body checking, and also to give a comment about the body checking. For example, this patient say, I look at naked at the mirror in front, from the side and behind, especially my belly, butt and legs for 5 minutes. And the comment is, they are full of cellulitis and my stomach has rolls of fat. I am disgusting. And this at 6:45. At 7 o'clock, I look at in the mirror my stomach while I was dressing. I changed it 3 dresses, 10 minutes to change dresses because she was unsatisfied. And the comment, my stomach is so fat, I feel sad, and she just a cup of skin and meals with cereal and one glass of orange juice. At school, she is an adolescent, I look at the Anna's flat stomach, a very rapid look, I take just a rapid look. She has a perfect body, not like me, that I look pregnant. I skipped the apple, I am so fat, I respected my plane. Bathroom, 2 o'clock, I check my belly, was increased with a rule, 2 minutes, it is increased. You know, I skipped the 2 cookies that I planned because my belly is too big, Okay, so you see the association between body checking, body dissatisfaction, and dietary restraint. Okay, here at 9 o'clock p.m., I look at some beautiful and skinny models in the web, 20 minutes, all have a flat stomach, not like me, I feel depressed, 200 push-up. Okay, so you see the interaction between the body checking, the psychopathology, body dissatisfaction, dietary restraint, exercising. This is a typical days of patient with eating disorder. Another problem of patient in responding to your interesting question about the perception of the body weight. You know that it's common to say that patient with anorexia nervosa has an altered perception of the body weight. They perceive a body weight that seems much bigger than the actual dimension of their body weight. In reality, the study that we made in Oxford and also in Villa Garda tend to support the hypothesis that the altered perception is a secondary phenomenon of the body checking. And if you look also at the DSM-5 and the formulation that I describe you of CBT, we don't include the alteration of body perception for several reasons. First of all, it's not pathognomonic of eating disorder, because there are people without eating disorder that has an alterated perception of the body weight. Okay, so it doesn't distinguish people with and without eating disorder. There are some people with eating disorder that have no the alterated body perception. On the contrary, the over-evaluation of shape and weight is common in eating disorder. Okay, and also it seems secondary to the way of the people look at their body. The idea comes from the study of, this arachnophobia. Unfortunately, the image is a mistake, sorry, but this there was an image with a big spider. It's the typical spider that the patient with the people with arachnophobia see, the spider. And if you ask to the people with arachnophobia, what you do when you enter in your room, they start to check. They check to look for the spider, okay? It's the first do they do. And when they see a spider, they focus on the spider, okay? Not on the circumstant environment, okay? They focus just on the spider, and they describe a spider very big, with two eyes, and very dangerous, and they become afraid, they have fear, okay, anxiety. But in reality, it's a very small spider, okay? And you see this little spider, but if you look, you focus on the spider, you amplify the perception of the spider. Yeah. And this happens also with the body checking, because the people with eating disorder focus on specific part of the body, and they scrutinize the specific part of the body. And this amplifies the perception of a defect. If you want to find fat, you find fat, okay? So if you want to become more dissatisfied with your body, start to check your body very often in this way. Don't do, but we made a study in Oxford. We a group of women was asked to do body checking several times a day to the mirror, and a woman was a control group, and we tested the body dissatisfaction after 4 weeks. And the woman that increased the body checking increased also the body dissatisfaction and also the negative perception they have about the body. Okay, so it seems that body checking is a crucial aspect in maintaining the body dissatisfaction of the patient. And once we assess the nature of a body checking with self-monitoring, we categorize the various forms of body checking. The best to be stopped altogether. So these are the unusual, non-normative body checking. So pinching part of the body to assess fatness, repeatedly touching the abdomen, thighs and arms, feeling bones. Usually they are secretive as they are associated with embarrassment if the others know. Use a tape, for example, to check thigh circumference. But we focus a lot on the body checking that is best to modify, not to eliminate. These are the mirror use and comparison making. And after step four, we help the patient to stop the non-normative form of body checking, okay? And we ask directly to stop. And we assess the mirror use and comparison checking. I spend few words on mirror use or comparison checking because are very common in the eating disorder patient. We assess the frequency of mirror use, and we ask the patient to monitor the mirror use and the manner of the mirror use. How long do you spend in looking the mirror in each occasion? What exactly is done? Which part you look and which are ignored or avoided? What are you trying to find out when you look at the mirror? Okay. And we educate also about the mirror and the mirror use. The mirror is a complex object. The things are not as appears. And we know that our perception is influenced by the way we look in the mirror, okay? The way and the state of mood that we have. For example, scrutiny magnifies the perceived defect. I show you the analogy with the arachnophobic. And the many patients use the mirror in the way to magnify the apparent size. And we draw a contrast with incidental reflection. For example, I had a patient who went in a shop. She looked at the window and said, look at this girl. She has a beautiful body. But after she looked more deeply and she saw that she was her body and she started to find defects. So, you know, this is the typical problems of body checking. The comparison checking is very superficial, and the body checking toward themselves is very deep, critical, etc. Another problem of the mirror is that it doesn't reflect the real image, but there is a neurological transformation of a dimension of our image, because for a physical characteristic of the mirror, we see our image that is the half of the real image. Here you see my two colleagues, the image that this colleague see her image in the mirror, and the other colleagues close to the mirror. You see that exactly the half of the image of the colleague. So we do a transformation, a neurological transformation of the image, of our perception. And if we look too much in the mirror, in this process, it's clear that we can have a problem, or if we can derive problematic perception of our body. And after, we ask the patient to modify how they use the mirror, and we ask the patient to ask the following question: what is the appropriate use of a mirror? What do you think? What is the appropriate use of a mirror?
When you need to get ready.
When you get to ready. There are other moments? No. You look, you can look the makeup, how are your dress, or the shave for us, not other moment, okay? What form of mirror use are inappropriate or unhelpful? So stay like the patient I described you, in front of mirrors for minutes without nude, without dressing? How can you avoid the magnification, not to stay, you know, to stay in detail, okay, because this increases the magnification. And we also discuss if they had difficulties in choosing what to wear and if they are going out. Another problem is the comparison making, and this is another type of body checking, very typical of patients with eating disorder. And there are two comparisons, with other people or with the media image. And this, there are two cognitive bias typical. One is a subjective bias, is the selective attention with someone who is attractive. For example, the patient that I describe you, that has, she felt that she had a too big stomach, she was selective in comparing herself with all the women with a flat stomach. But she didn't look at all the other women in the world that have no a flat stomach. Very few have a flat stomach. Okay. And also there is also the assessment bias, because they give a superficial look to the other. They take a look very rapidly, and so on the selective person, and very rapidly. Completely different on how the patient looks to her body, that is very deep, many times, in detail. So this type of comparison tend to maintain, of course, the body dissatisfaction and the idea that I have something wrong, okay? I go on. Another problem is addressing the media images comparison, and we ask the patient to monitor this comparison, magazines, internet, and we educate patient about, with example, on the manipulation of image, the airbrushing, the Photoshop effect that, you know, is a disaster in our society, and to do also some research. Here I had two videos, but I don't know if we can see, that are made by Dove to help a woman to improve the body image. One is evolution, and the other is real beauty stretch. The idea is to inoculate the patient against the uncritical acceptance of media image. These are some images, but you can find a lot of images in the web. This is a very nice actress, okay, I don't know, you know, but you see, she's very nice, but they manipulate the image. Look at, you know, the chin is different, the arms are different, you know, the belly is different, the legs, is another person, okay. It's not the real body. She is a very nice woman, but it's not enough. They have to change the shape of her. But our young girls look at this body, this is my image, that is unnatural. Very few women has a body like this. Also, the very important actress, they have not this body. Okay, very beautiful actress. This is, I try to, is a YouTube. Okay, I can show you the. Okay, we go on. I have no time to conclude all the treatment, I'm very sorry, because we need 2 days to conclude all the description of the treatment. However, I just describe you briefly all the strategy we use. We address also body avoidance, and also here there are many forms of body avoidance. For example, avoidance the sight of the body, or avoidance the touch of the body, or avoidance other scenes of the body. And the patient is encouraged to to expose to her gradually to her bodies. And we address also feeling fat, that it seems it is not an emotion feeling fat, but we think that is a labeling of certain experience, like body awareness or adverse physical states or adverse emotional states. And the patient report peak of feeling fat, okay, why the body weight is usually stable. So means that we help the patient to identify the peak and to identify the association, what happened when they feel fat. And sometimes they report, I was sad, I made body checking, okay, or I feel full because I eat too much. So we try to help the patient to, when they feel fat, to label correctly they feel fat. I feel fat because I am sad. I feel fat because I am full. I feel fat because my dress is too tight. Not equate, I feel fat because I am fat, okay? In the other module that we address is dietary restraint, because we address one form of dietary restraint that was when to eat, okay? But there are other dietary rules, is what to eat, how much to eat. So we help the patient to identify the dietary rules. We ask the patient to, for example, to make a list of all the avoided food and gradually to introduce the food and to see, to predict what happened and to see what happened. When the patient see that the negative consequences do not appear, for example, increasing body weight because I introduce some chocolate or other food that I avoid, where is what we call inhibitory learning of the anxiety. So the patient can understand that the dietary rule is not necessary to control the body weight, okay? And the rules stop to become useful, but become a way to an effort way to control the body weight, and the goal is to help gradually the patient to become more flexible in the diet and at the same time to eat in a healthy way, to follow what we call healthy guideline in a flexible way. And we address all the rules of the patient, the avoidance, the portion, eating with others, eating the restaurant, eating food that I don't know, the calorie content, and things like this. The events and moods module is a derivation of a linear approach to address borderline personality disorder, very focused in helping the patient to modulate the mood. And we start with simple strategies, that is problem solving, to address the event that are influence eating. And with the patient with mood intolerance, severe mood intolerance, we do a specific modules of mood intolerance. The last module is setback and mindset. When the patient, as I told you this morning, start reduce the preoccupation of body weight and shape, and as an intermittent state in and out from the eating disorder, we help the patient to recognize the trigger that are activating the eating disorder, immediately recognize it, and to do the opposite. So we move to a more metacognitive approach of a eating disorder, to recognize the trigger, the mindset, and to the center from the mindset, doing the opposite that the mindset. And this is, we call the manipulation of the mindset, to learn how to manage the mindset. When the patient learns to manage the mindset without a step back is a behaviors, okay, like dieting or binging or things like this, the patient become more and more able to manipulate the mindset, and gradually the tendency to the mindset to activate in the consequence of trigger decrease in time. And you see after the patient say, now I can go also to see in the mirrors or I eat food that I don't know the content, and I don't activate anymore the mindset. The last part of the treatment is stage four. We do another assessment of eating disorder. We take a detailed look to the improvement, but also on the residual feature of eating disorder, and we develop with the patient a short-term maintenance plan where we include the feature to address and the procedure to use in the next month when the treatment is finished. And at the same time, we develop a long-term maintenance plan to reduce the risk of relapse. Okay, this is crucial. You see the description of these two aspects in the manual. We didn't speak about the people underweight, but the process is similar. I explained this morning. We have a stage one very similar, but we give education about the underweight, the negative effect of underweight, how the underweight maintains the eating disorder psychopathology. And in step two, we address weight regain, helping the patient to create a positive energy balance of 500 calories per week, per day. That means that the aim is to increase 0.5 kilogram per week. And at the same time, we address the psychopathology. The goal is to help the patient to reach a low normal body weight. Is a body weight that the patient can maintain without dietary restriction, and it is not associated with a starvation symptom. In most of the patients is a BMI around 19, okay? And after, we work a lot to maintain the body weight with a flexible eating plan. And at the same time, we address the psychopathology using the same modules I described for the patient that are not underweight. I'm finished. I'm sorry for that I was not able to describe in detail all the modules, but you have all the slides. For me, it is important that you understand in general, the theory of a treatment, the approach of a treatment, and the strategy we use to treat eating disorder. If you want to work with eating disorder, you like this treatment, you can read manuals, you can do the web training, or to read the slide that I give, but all these are instruments to improve and to become expert in treatment eating disorder. Thank you.